Penguin Random House Audio presents To Cook a Bear by Mikael Niemi. Translated from the Swedish by Deborah Bragan Turner. Read for you by Anthony Mark Barrow and Allan Corduner. Schengis, northern Sweden. Close to the Finnish border. 1852. Part 1. Out in the forest, writing a line, my faithful damsel singing so fine. My deepest wish, invading your heart, the pain of love to thee will impart. Chapter 1. Awake to a complete absence of sound in a world biding its time before coming to life, enclosed by darkness and sky. I lie with my eyes directed like conduits toward the great expanse, but there is nothing there, not even air. In the midst of the vast silence, my chest begins to tremble and shake. The waves intensify. Something growing inside threatens to force its way out. My ribs are pried apart like the bars of a cage. There's nothing I can do except submit to this formidable force. Like a child groveling on the floor at the feet of an enraged father, never knowing when the next blow will strike. I am that child. I am that father. Before the world is fully formed, I rush out into the dawn with my knapsack on my back and the hand-forged axe in my fist. A short distance from the low barn, I stop and shelter at the edge of the forest, pretending to busy myself with my clothing in case someone should see me and start to wonder. I wind a shoelace round and round, empty my cap of invisible lice, pretending to shake them onto the swarming antler at my feet. All the while, I watch the farmyard out of the corner of my eye. The first smoke of the morning rises from the cabin stove, signaling that the household is astir. And then she emerges. Empty pails swing from her hands. Her headscarf stands out, white, like a winter ptarmigan. Her face is a circle of light, her eyes bright, her brows dark. I imagine the smoothness of her cheeks and her small rosy lips singing softly, shaping tender little words. The cows, their udders taut, low in response and expectation when she opens the heavy barn door and slips inside. It all happens at such speed, far too fast. And I try to keep my senses sharp, to hold this picture so that I can summon it again and again. And yet it is not enough. I have to see her tomorrow as well. Her swinging hips under the apron, the gentle round of her bosom, the hand that grips the latch on the barn door. I steal closer, almost breaking into a run across the farmyard, as if I were a thief. And at the door, I stop. I let my hand close round the handle. My rough, sinewy hand on the place where hers, so small and soft, has just been. Inside, her fingers squeezing the cow's large teats, squirting white jets into the pail. For a split second, I pull on the handle as if to enter, but I promptly turn and hurry away, afraid someone will have seen me. But I keep it in my hand for the rest of the day. The warmth from her skin. Chapter 2. At mealtimes, I always wait until last. I hold back in the corner while the pastor's wife places the heavy cauldron of oatmeal on the table. It is smoking and black as death on the outside, as though fetched straight from the devil's inferno. But inside, the porridge is light and golden, slightly grainy, creamy where it sticks to the wooden ladle. Brita Kaitha, stirs with a broad wooden spatula, digging down to the bottom and then up again, breaking the skin that has formed on top and filling every corner of the cabin with the aroma of hay and pollen. The children and hard hands sit waiting. I see their pale faces, a silent wall of hunger, her expression stern. She takes the bowls and gives large scoops to the older and smaller dollops to the younger ones. She serves the workers and the visitors who have dropped in. When they have all received their share, heads are lowered and fingers intertwined across the table. The pastor waits until there is quiet. Then he too bows his head and gives heartfelt thanks for everyone's daily bread. They eat in silence, apart from the sound of chewing and the licking of wooden spoons. The older want more, and more is given. The breaking of bread, the eating of cold boiled pike with deft fingers, bones piling up on the table like shiny pins. When everyone has almost finished, the mistress will chance to cast an eye toward the corner where I sit.
Come and eat too.
It doesn't matter. But come and sit down.
Make room for you, see, children.
I can wait. I see the master turn as well. His eyes are glazed. I detect the pain in them and how he struggles to conceal it. A brief nod from him brings me to the table. I hold out my guksi, the wooden cup I crafted myself up in Karaswando, the one that has accompanied me on my life's journey. At first it was white as the skin of a suckling babe. Over time, it is darkened with sun and salt and a thousand washings. I feel the weight when the mistress empties her ladle and I watch her scrape the sides to gather more. But I am already back in my corner, cross-legged on the floor. The sticky, barley-tasting porridge I devour has cooled by now to the same temperature as my mouth. I feel it slip down my throat, then enclosed by my stomach's muscles. There it grows into the strength and warmth that will help keep me alive. I eat like a dog, ravenous and watchful.
Come and have some more,
the mistress urges. But she knows I will not come. I eat only once. I take my allotted portion, never more. The cup is empty. I wipe my thumb like a swab round the curved surface and pass my tongue over it. I lick and suck until it is all clean. It slides gently into my pocket. The cup is what provides me with food, drawing to it the edible things that happenstance delivers. Many times, weak with hunger, I've been close to collapse. But whenever I took out my cup, it was filled with a fish's head or a reindeer's blood, or with frozen berries from a mountain slope, just like that. And I have eaten and regained my strength, enough to withstand the day. This is all I hope for, and this is how I have survived. This is why I sit down on the floor. For never would I assert myself or make demands, never snatch like a raven or snarl like a wolverine. I would rather turn aside. If no one sees me, I stay in the shadows. But the mistress, she sees me. I ask for nothing, but she provides nonetheless. Her brusque kindness, the same concern for all beings, for cows, for dogs. All living things need to survive. That is about the size of it. I might leave at any moment, as a wanderer does. I'm here now, and the next thing you know, I am somewhere else. I get to my feet, grab my knapsack, and walk. That is all. When you are poor, you can live like this. Everything I own, I carry with me. Clothes on my back, knife in my belt, fire striker and cup, horn spoon, pouch of salt. Their combined weight is almost nothing. I'm agile and fleet of foot. In the next river valley before anyone misses me. There's hardly a trace of me left behind, no more than an animal's. My feet tread on grass and moss that spring back up. When I build a fire, I use old fire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.